Hello everyone. So I would like to take you across today in regards to precast production for beams. So let us start. In regards to beam, I'm going to cover how normal conventional precast beams are produced. That means no pre-stressing. Then how rectangular, L-shaped, T-shaped, etc. pre-stressed precast beams are produced, and specifically how double T beams are produced. So these are primarily few categories of beams which I would like to take up in these initial lecture series. Alright, so let us start. Now double T's, double T's are very efficient beams. They are primarily used for long spans. For spans greater than 20 meters or so, double T beams are quite effective. So they primarily act like a slab. So let's say for longer spans up to 15 meters or 16 meters, you can go to use hollow core slabs as well for higher loadings, but after around 16 to 17 meters, after 16 meter span, the effectiveness of the utilizations of hollow core slabs, it's used. I mean to say the entire capacity of hollow core slabs is used. The maximum thickness of hollow core slab, which is primarily available in the market, is around 500 mm. So that capability of hollow core slabs to take up the load beyond 16 meter span is utilized after that. No matter what is the strength of concrete or number of strand patterns, also even if you increase or if you use higher grade of concrete, that capacity of hollow core slab extinguishes, I would say. Beyond that, double T beams or slabs come into picture. So I'm going to take you across through production limitations. What are the weight limitations you have to consider for what is the weight limitation considerations? Then double T specifically is restricted to the equipment. So there are series of double T's which you can produce using a available mold. Alright, so it has got certain, you can say, permutations and combinations of geometries of these double T's that you can produce given the equipment a production facility has. So thereby your moment of inertia or the geometry of the double T is restricted. So a designer has to select from one of these profiles and then he has to utilize effective profile for the given loading for his project. That's the best you can do. Certainly you have to design that double T for a specific geometry and you can economize that as well, but you are restricted within those permutations and combinations. So let me take you through this. So I would show you some of the few standard charts of double T's. So let's say this is an effective double T profile. Given this particular profile, you work out the moment capacity for a given span, what is allowable loading and so on. So these are standard charts which a structural designer can produce, and then effectively you keep on using it based on your projects. Alright, and I'll show you one more chart from a standard factory supplier. Alright, so this is a standard double T. Within the double T, in order to reduce the weight or to achieve diaphragm action and so on, half of the slab topping of the double T could be casted on the site after placement of the diaphragm rebars, some connection rebars and so on. Alright, but this is a standard double T profile that you can see over here. Alright, so that's it from this particular chart. So these are standard load charts of double T's. Now I'm going to take you across production of double T so that you get better clarity and an idea. So let me quickly take you across through that. In this particular double T fabrication, it's a typical bolt of the profile that I've shown it to you earlier. Similar kind of a nature of a profile you can achieve it. And there is abutment on either side of this double T, and we have pre-stressing strands. So if you look at this profile, alright, so there are pre-stressing strands in this particular web of double T. Okay, within this web of double T, there are series of strands. I'll show you in some of the images as well. Okay, so let me show you some of the images of double T's, so you'll get a fair idea about it. So let's say these are some of the images of the double T's. As you can see, these are the strands of double T's. Okay, and this is half slab and so on. These are the produced double T slabs. Okay, so this is the final output that you'll achieve it, and this is erected, you know, for a particular building. Alright, so you'll get a feel of it, how it looks like and what kind of a structural component it is. A very beautiful finish from the factory, and it looks, you know, very good for long span structures, and no need to do any plastering or anything like that. And it's a very economical structure, very economical structural element for long spans, you know. So now let's go quickly as to see how you can produce these double T's. So let me start. Alright, so this is the double T typical bed of the mold that you are seeing over here. Okay, now this is how the laying of pre-stressing strands is being done. You can see, as per the your designers, you know, whatever number of strands you want and whatever number of layers you can have it. Typically, this distance is of the order of 2 inch, that is 50 mm. Okay, so this distance is 50 mm, and this is a distance of 1 inch of a strand. Okay, it also depends from supplier to supplier. So this is a typical mold, because as you can see, in order to achieve that profile of concrete, this mold is there. That's it, you pour the concrete. So this will be your flange area, this inside whatever depth you go, this is the web area. So here if you pour the concrete, you'll get the webs, here you'll get a flange. So you can, you know, imagine this particular mold. So now, you know, they are just putting the cover blocks, and let's say, you know, if you have some sockets or connections, these are some connections of double T's with adjacent elements being done. Okay, end notch preparations are being done, and they've, so this is a end detail of double T. That's why so much amount of extra shuttering is done. Now this is cover block for the top flange. Now you will see how the pre-stressing strands are being stretched. So typically, you know, we all know that you cannot measure the accurateness, the accuracy of the strain which is induced in these tendons. So we typically measure the elongation. It's very easy. So whatever delta L is there, and we assume that whatever delta L or whatever the pulling of the strands we have done, effectively that much amount of pressure would have been transferred to that particular strand. All right. And you can see now the top rebar placement is being done. Pre-stressing strands are being stretched. Okay. So initial marking of the strand is done, and then final length is measured. You can see the effective stressing of the strand is being done, and elongation is measured. Now reinforcement is being placed. Okay, this is a magnetic shutter for the top slab. Okay, so typically, you know, we all use welded wire mesh or, you know, manually mesh also, but it takes a lot of time. So it's a typical mesh generally we have. So welded wire mesh are quite efficient. It reduces a lot of amount of time. Okay, now these are the lifters which are being placed to lift these double T's and then finally pour the concrete, you know. So obviously this assembly has also got high frequency vibrator motors attached to the mold, and below you know, the mold we also have pipes for steam curing, for increasing the curing speed to enhance or advance the curing. You know, sometimes we do have steam curing process because it's a factory environment, so it's very easily achievable. So, you know, the top finish is done. Now this is a broom finish because there's another layer of slab that is going to come on site. Okay, so now demolding of double T's is being done. And finally the double T's are taken out of the mold. Alright, so you can see they are removing some shutters. These are the strands which finally, you know, you can cut it. So whatever openings, MEP openings, cutouts you require could be achieved during the production stage itself. You can see the quality of finish and the long span of double T that is being produced. So while designing this double T, obviously there is a gantry crane limitation at the top, because within the factory the weight of the double T is also restricted by the gantry or the crane capacity as well. So that one of the designers needs to take care of it and take it into account. Otherwise, you know, sometimes the double T molds are kept open in an open factory environment wherein you can have the, you know, mobile cranes or external crane lifting that particular double T. So in that case, you know, you have freedom to little bit adjust your tonnage of the double T's because you have flexibility of mobile cranes. These are the fixed gantry cranes, right? So within the factory environment, you are limited to obey the rules and principles of productions. Then finally, you know, the strands are slacked and the cleaning of the bed takes place, and then, you know, again the next strip of the oiling is being done, and then next pouring of the double T's would be done. Alright, so I think with this let me conclude our double T production. Okay, and let me take you through our presentation again. So this is a final image of double T being used for a car park project and how it looks like. Okay, so I think I have given you enough clarity in regards to productions of double T's, what are the limitations in regards to weight that you need to consider, and I have told you that within this catalog of double T, by variations of the strands or you know top slab thickness and so on, primarily you can play around with the double T sizes. That's it. That's the best you can do. And now let's move ahead towards the costing part of it. So the costing, typically, you know, it depends upon what length of bed of double T you want. But primarily, let me show you the costings of for, you know, 75 meter length. So you get a rough idea that what is the costing per meter and so on, right? So the costing of a 75 meter double T slab or beam, you can say, comes out to be around 3 crores. This is X factory. That means transportation and logistics is separate. So you get, what do you get in this? You get an entire mold that is including commissioning and installation of a 75 meter length of double T. Abutment also is included within this, and this setup requires a fixed abutment. You know, it's not a modular kind of an abutment. I have given you the costings for fixed abutment, remember this. And it also includes pre-stressing jacks and, you know, high frequency vibrator motors and things like that. So this doesn't include your curing mechanism, okay, steam curing mechanism that I was talking about. This costing doesn't include that. So using this as a benchmark, one can understand the costing to set up this double T molds. All right, this is a brief about double T fabrications approach and its costing. Now let me take you through normal precast beams and its molds and how it's done. Now this is a typical precast mold. Here also we have abutments at two ends wherein we pull the strands, we do pre-stressing, and then typically, you know, this beam size you can achieve is about 1 meter by 1 meter by 1 meter. So within this rectangle of 1 meter by 1 meter, you know, whatever size you want, you can vary, and then the molds could be adjusted accordingly, you know. All right, so the procedure of fabrication of this precast beams, pre-stressed precast beams, is same as what I've shown you for double T's. You apply the you clean the beds, you apply oiling to the shuttering, then you put the strands, put the rebar cages. Here you have rebar cages, and double T's you didn't have much. All right, and then you put the shutters and pour the concrete, and your pre-stressed precast beams are done. On the same bed you can achieve precast beams. You don't require separate, you know, bed. In precast beams you just would have strand pattern. So if in your building, if your beams don't require pre-stressing, don't do it. On the same bed you can achieve, you know, precast beams as well. And remember one thing, the weight needs to be accommodated as per the gantry crane capacity which is running on top of this particular bed or in this particular bay in the factory wherein this precast beams are being fabricated. I would insist again and again on this weight constraint, because lot of designers miss out on that. And remember, if you exceed the weight capacity, the production unit will not be able to utilize this bed to fabricate the beam, because internally they will not be able to lift using this gantry. If at all they have a space wherein the mobile crane can enter in the factory premises or the production hub, then they can demold it and take it out of the factory. So please ensure each and every precast element that you design sits within the weight limitation, that is the overhead gantry crane capacity, your trailer capacity, then your tower crane capacity at the erection stage as well. All these factors needs to be considered to arrive at the weight limitations, okay. And the geometry limitations would be governed by the equipments that the production factory is having. So here in this case I'm showing you typically 1 meter by 1 meter size you can achieve, it maximum size, okay. And typically this abutment that you see, this is spaced at 50 mm center to center in horizontal and vertical dimensions. So within this you can play around with your strand pattern of the beam,
And you know, you can design your beams accordingly. So stand patterns right from 19.3 to 12.5 to 15.7 variable strands, you can achieve it based on you know your designs. That's not a problem. Okay, so let me show you some of the images for pre-stressed precast beam. So this is a typical abutment that you see for a normal pre-stressed precast beams. This is another kind of a pre-stressed precast beam. This is called as a modular assembly of a pre-stressed precast beam or a self pre-stressing bed. So you can move this assembly from side to side and you can cast your pre-stressed precast beam, and whatever pre-stressing forces are there, they are taken by this abutment. The weight of this particular assembly takes care of that. So this modular pre-stressed precast beam assembly is a very costly affair. You know, your cost shoots up, whereas your permanent facility that I have shown you earlier of pre-stressed precast beam cost you roughly, you know, anywhere up to 2 crores, and that modular in nature, that will cost you roughly about anywhere up to 4 to 4.5 crores, something of that sort. So I always prefer, you know, a fixed setup if at all you don't have much requirement from side to side basis. So this is how your pre-stressed precast beam would look like. So within that 1 meter by 1 meter range, you can achieve all of this. So primarily, you know, this is your stand patterns. You can have T beams, L beams, and whatever you like. Okay, so this is how it is. So then it is pulled from the factory to the stockyard using this railing and chain assembly. Okay, so this is how your caging is done, and then your side shutters would be put up. You have magnetic side shutters, and the end shutter is always done, you know, based on the profiles and segments you have. Okay, so these are side shutters, steel side shutters for proper finish. This is the internal view of the abutment, how it looks like, you know, while you do the pre-stressing. And these are some of the fabricated beams, you know, how it looks like. So these are the lifters, rebar. So the topping on the beams are generally done at site to achieve diaphragm loads and so on, and proper connection with the slab. So this ledge is given maybe because the slab or hollow core slab is something is sitting on this particular beam. Okay, and so on. So these are dowel bars for connections with the columns, beam connection with the column, and so on. All right, so you can easily, you know, notice the strand patterns at top and bottom. Okay, all right. So this is a brief about how pre-stressed precast beams and normal precast beams could be fabricated. All right, and this entire setup of precast beams fabrications, this setup would cost you around 2 crores. This includes the bottom bed, the side abutments, then side shutters up till the length of 135 meters. Effectively, I consider roughly about 0.7 of the total length. So 70% is the effective production area. If you have too many small pieces of beams, then your effectiveness reduces. If you have long span beams, your effectiveness increases, because you know the side shutters, that is this shutter for every beam, is required at two ends. So this at least occupies, you know, 300 mm space on either ends. So in between two beams, I would assume, let's say, 1 meter space is gone just like that. So the more number of smaller beams you have, effectiveness reduces. The you know, larger spans you have, effectiveness increases, and so on. It depends upon the production person, how best he utilizes this bed to fabricate and how best he does production planning. So this 2 crores includes the molds, abutments, high frequency vibrators and motors, and so on. This also doesn't include the curing facility. Okay, so the steam curing is not included within this particular costing or budget. All right, so with this, I would like to conclude our sessions for beam production. Okay guys, and we'll see you with the next session. Thank you so much. Thank you.